Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome everyone to the Marin Coalition's first ever virtual presentation featuring our guest, Mr. Noah Griffin. My name is Scott Pinsky. I'm the chair of the Marin Coalition. I'll be your moderator today. We're all experiencing this pandemic in our own ways, but to the surprise of many, these circumstances have led to a wealth of new online content, and Marin Coalition is pleased to be a part of that. Today's program will be the first of an ongoing series that we'll be bringing you throughout this 2021 season. So please watch for other programs and check out our website for future programs, as well as other programs that we intend to create over the next few months. You can also check out our website for past programs. We're recording today's event, and it will be available online on our website, marincoalition.org. Our next event will be September 17, starting at noon, when we will have the Marin Registrar of Voters, Linda Roberts, to discuss the upcoming November elections. In light of the daily drip of news about election security, postal interference, Russian hacking, and so forth, this is a topic that should interest us all. Then on Thursday, October 8, we will invite local political rock stars Dick Spotswood and Greg Brockbank for another pre-election roundup, an event that every informed voter in Marin will need to hear. For today's presentation, we've created a portal for you to send in your questions for Noah if you would like. Just click on the Q&A button at the bottom of your Zoom window, and we will see your questions. I'll try and get as many of them in today as we can. We're probably going to go for an hour and a half or so, and as many questions as we can address during that time, we will do so. We're fortunate to be able to take advantage of the recent invention of electricity to bring you this and all of our virtual programs at no cost. And we hope that by presenting these free programs, we'll be able to reach a larger audience and a more diverse one and bring many more people into the conversation. If you'd like to support our programs, feel free to visit our website and you can make a donation there in any amount. Let's get to today's program. Today, we're pleased to welcome Bay Area native son, Mr. Noah Griffin. When introducing a man of Noah's breadth of accomplishment, it's truly hard to know where to start. Most of you have probably read his columns, and so you identify him with politics and journalism. Well, that would be right. Noah's political awareness began early. His father was an early civil rights advocate, and his mom, an educator. As a young member of the San Francisco Boys Chorus, he sang at the Republican National Convention at the Cow Palace in 1956. He recalls receiving his first impression of the political divide in the country when President Eisenhower's motorcade whisked by him and his fellow musicians in a flash. Later, as a student, he saw Nixon speak, he studied with Archibald Cox, and he interviewed Bill Clinton, whose campaign he later joined. Noah is a graduate of the Fisk University in Nashville, after which he went on to earn his law degree from Harvard Law School before embarking on a storied career working with some of California's leading political and business figures. He began his official work in public affairs through his appointment by Mayor Joe Alioto to the Mayor's Council on Criminal Justice. He then served on the staffs of former San Francisco Mayor Frank Jordan, Senator Dianne Feinstein, and financial giant Charles Schwab, among others. As a journalist, Noah's career has been one filled with firsts. He became the first full-time Black talk show host on KGO Radio in San Francisco from 1980 to 1982, where he continued to work as a weekend host until 1985. He was the first Black op-ed columnist for the San Francisco Examiner, the first African-American on the San Francisco Examiner editorial board, the first Black San Francisco nationally syndicated columnist through an award from the Scripps Howard Foundation, and the first San Francisco columnist ever to appear on the PBS NewsHour. Noah has also hosted talk radio shows on KGO, KFRC, and K101. He's written op-ed pieces and served on the editorial board of the San Francisco Examiner. He's written for the Boston Globe, and he's appeared frequently in the Marin Independent Journal, where he also served on the editorial board. By now, you're no doubt asking yourselves, so is that all? Not by a long shot. Noah's had another entirely separate career, no less distinguished, as a vocal performer. His stage career began as a child with the San Francisco Boys Chorus and the San Francisco Cosmopolitan Opera. In 1955, he was the first Black youngster to perform a solo with the San Francisco Cosmopolitan Opera in La Boheme. The same year, Noah sang with the chorus at the opening of the original Disneyland in Anaheim. By the age of 12, he'd shared the stage with Paul Robeson, Leontine Price, Johnny Ray, Nat King Cole, and he had performed in Carmen, Turandot, and Boris Godunov. He continued to sing at the Venetian Room at the Fairmont Hotel and at the legendary Purple Onion, among many other venues. Noah later founded the Cole Porter Society, which is dedicated to keeping the great songwriter's legacy alive. He currently directs that with his wife, Meredith. The Choral Foundation Fellowship in Public Affairs and the Phelps Stokes History Fellowship are among the many awards that Noah has received. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my great pleasure to introduce our guest, Noah Griffin.
Thank you, Scott. I'd like that all written out, as I said it, and said at my funeral. Thank you so very much. I appreciate that very warm introduction. In order to find out where we are, I think we have to know where we've been. And I'm going to start today with giving an historical arc of African-American history in the country and right up to the present. The noted sociologist and economist and racial visionary W.B. Du Bois is quoted as having written, "True freedom and equality for the African-American is but an ever-receding mirage." In other words, just when you think you see the oasis of complete freedom and equality, it is but a false illusion. Is this time different? Has the murder of George Floyd finally brought America to a time of racial reckoning, a true tipping point beyond which the coalition of white and blacks intent on social justice will bring about significant and lasting change? We thought so at different historical junctures, only to see America yield to political expediency. America was the very first nation in the history of the world to invent the classification of whiteness. Let me quote from Isabel Wilkerson's bestseller, Caste, C-A-S-T-E. "The American caste system began in the years after the arrival of the first Africans to the Virginia colony in the summer of 1619. As the colony, such refined the distinctions of who could be enslaved for life and who could not. Over time, colonial laws granted English and Irish indentured servants greater privileges than the Africans who worked alongside of them. And the Europeans were fused into a new identity that has now been categorized as white, the polar opposite of black. The historian Kenneth Stamp called this an assigning of race a caste system, which divided those whose appearance enabled them to claim pure Caucasian ancestry from those whose appearance indicated that some or all of the forebears were Negroes. Members of the Caucasian caste, as he called, believed in white supremacy and maintained a high degree of solidarity to secure it. As a window into their exploitation, consider that in 1740, South Carolina, like other slaveholding states, finally decided to limit the workday of enslaved African Americans to 15 hours from March to September, and 14 hours from September to March, double the normal workday for humans who actually got paid for their labor. In that same era, common prisoners found guilty of actual crimes were kept to a maximum of 10 hours per workday. Let no one say that African Americans as a group have not worked for our country. Thus, each new immigrant, the ancestors of most current day Americans, walked into a pre-existing hierarchy, bipolar in construction, arising from slavery, and pitting extremes of human pigmentation at opposite ends. Each new immigrant had to figure out how and where to position themselves in the hierarchy of the new adopted land. Oppressed people from around the world, particularly from Europe, passed through Ellis Island, shed their old selves, and often their old names to gain admittance to the powerful dominant majority. Somewhere in the journey, Europeans became something they had never been or needed to be before. They went from being Czech or Hungarian or Polish to white, a political designation that has only meaning when set against something that was black. They would join a new creation, an umbrella category for anyone who entered the New World from Europe. Germans gained acceptance as part of the dominant caste in the 1840s. According to immigration and legal scholar Ian Henry Lopez, the Irish in the 1850s to the 1880s and the Eastern and Southern Europeans in the early 20th century, he was becoming American and then they became white. In Ireland or Italy, Lopez writes, whatever social or racial identity in these people they might have possessed, being white wasn't one of them. Serbs and Albanians, Swedes and Russians, Turks and Bulgarians, who might have been at war with one another back in their mother countries, fused together on the basis not of shared ethnic culture or language or faith or national origin, but on the basis of what they look like in order to strengthen the dominant caste in this hierarchy. James Baldwin was said, no one was white before he or she came to America. The idea of race is a recent phenomenon in human history. It dates back to the start of the transatlantic slave trade, to the subsequent caste system that arose from slavery. The word race is likely derived from the Spanish word raza, and was originally used to refer to the caste or quality of authentic horses, which are branded with an iron so as to be recognized, wrote the anthropologist Audrey and Brian Smedley. As Europeans explore the New World, they began using the word refer to the new people they encountered. Ultimately, the English in North America, Africa, developed the most rigid and exclusive form of race ideology. The Smedleys wrote, race in the American mind was and is a statement about unabridged differences. It conveys the meaning of social distance that cannot be transcended. When I look back on our nation's history, built on a foundation of human bondage, I think of the long struggle to live up to our founding ideals, the shortcuts, the compromises we made, the moral debt we incurred, eventually paid in painful installments. Thomas Jefferson, a slave owner himself, originally included in the Declaration of Independence a 168-word passage condemning slavery as one of the evils foisted upon the colonies by the British Crown. It was cut from the final wording, disallowing the Enlightenment ideals of freedom and equality to apply to the enslaved. 5,000 Black people fought for revolutionary freedom, but none of us were then set free. I was inspired to write, in consonance with Frederick Douglass, what the 4th of July meant to the slave. I don't know really what it's worth to celebrate July the 4th, pay tribute to our nation's past when in the slave role we were cast. Somehow the nation has forgot the part we played within that plot to break the back of subjugation born of Britain's rank taxation. 5,000 soldiers of my hue gave battle to ensure that you enjoyed the fruits of liberty, though none of us were then set free. But promises were freely made that after battle we could trade our chains for spoils of victory and join with free humanity. But lobbies strong of Southern view made mockery of leaders who would make the Constitution stand for liberty throughout the land. In every war from then we thought that if we battled, if we fought, you'd recognize our loyalty and in due course would set us free. It took the spilling of your blood with ours upon this native sod. In freedom's name, you paid the price, the ultimate in sacrifice, to mount, in fact, a great crusade to right the error that you made by failing to make us a part of this great nation from the start. Indeed, the first to fall in the revolutionary struggle was a Black man, Crispus Attucks. Black soldiers were at Lexington, Concord, and Bunker Hill. Many of the Blacks fought for the crown as they offered Blacks their freedom. Any thought of slavery would die out on its own. It's vanished in 1792 with the invention of the cotton gin, which revolutionized the production of cotton, breathing life into an otherwise inefficient and moribund industry. Thus, the rationalization for slavery shifted from a necessary evil to a positive good. Listen to this. Cotton was this nation's leading export from 1803 to 1937. When I think of that, I hear the ringing words of civil rights activist, singer, and actor Paul Robeson as he spoke before a congressional hearing in 1942. He said, because my father was a slave and my people died to build this country, I'm going to stay here and have a part of it just like you, and no fascist-minded people are going to drive me from it. With the boys' chorus, I had the privilege of singing with Paul Robeson in 1957. He sang at the Third Baptist Church in San Francisco. It never occurred to me as a youngster why with his stature he could not command the Civic Auditorium. We were in the midst of the McCarthy era, and he was thought to be a communist sympathizer. To familiarize you who may not know who he was a four-letter man, straight-A student at Rutgers, graduating in 1919, Phi Beta Kappa. He played professional football, graduated from Columbia Law, dropped the practice of law when a white secretary at the firm he worked at refused to take dictation from him. He was the prototype for Gershwin's Borgi and became an acclaimed and renowned singer, actor, movie star. He was stripped of his passport, which one of my law professors, Leonard Bodine, won back from him. Let's go back to our historical arc. Another compromise was effected in 1787, ratification of the United States Constitution, when slaves were counted as 3/5 a person for purposes of seats in the House of Representatives. That gave the South 1/3 more seats and 1/3 more electoral votes. After the 1803 bloody overthrow of Napoleon and the French in Haiti by Toussaint Louverture sent shockwaves that reverberated through the nation, having a free, independent Black nation on America's doorsteps. The next accommodation was the Compromise of 1820, when Maine entered the Union balanced by Missouri's statehood, leaving the equation at 12 free states, 12 slave states. That date sticks back for me because it's the year of my great-great-grandfather's birth in this country. Two significant events occurred in 1831, Nat Turner's slave uprising in Virginia, and the publication of William Lloyd Garrison's Liberator newspapers in Boston, making a major step in the advancement of abolitionism. You would think Massachusetts, later a hotbed of Yankee anti-slavery sentiment, would have welcomed Garrison, but not then. The textile industry of New England made slavery a profit center for them, hence the phrase the Lords of the Loom and the Lords of the Lash. Garrison was almost lynched the first year of his newspaper's publication. A little known event took place in Boston in 1849, where a little Black girl, Sarah Roberts, filed a lawsuit argued by Robert Morris and then future Senator, co-counsel, Charles Sumner. Little Sarah had to walk past three perfectly fine schools to get to her dilapidated segregated institution. For the first time, it was argued that separate was inherently unequal. Judge Lemuel Shaw argued the case could not be settled upon philosophical grounds. Later, when Sumner's allies gained the majority in the State House, the law was overturned. You may note that separate being inherently unequal was the same argument advanced 105 years later by Thurgood Marshall. America compromised once more over slavery in 1850, settling the slave and free state confrontation resulting from the territories gained in the Mexican-American War. California came in as a free state, and New Mexico, Utah territories would be determined by popular sovereignty, whether they would allow or disallow slavery. To sweeten the pot for the South, heavy restrictions were added to the fugitive slave law. An uneasy truce lasted until 1854, when Stephen Douglas blew up the Missouri Compromise. Now slavery above the 3630 parallel, organizing Kansas and Nebraska territories, brought about the principle of popular sovereignty. Hence, Bleeding Kansas, where John Brown and others rushed in to swell the ranks and make the territory free in opposition to the slavery elements. In 1856, Sumner, now a United States Senator, was nearly caned to death on the floor of the Senate upon delivering a scathing attack of Senator Butler of South Carolina, who supported slavery. Butler's cousin, Preston Brooks, nearly beat Sumner to death on the floor of the United States Senate chambers. Many marked that as the first blows of the Civil War. Another significant event was the 1857 Dred Scott decision, where Scott, an enslaved man and his wife, were transported by their master to the free Minnesota Territory, where once ensconced, they were technically free, but that did not happen. They sued in a series of cases eventually decided by the Supreme Court. The opinion was authored by Roger B. Taney, who ironically, in Luther versus Borden, originated the phrase judicial restraint. Ironic because he went well beyond what was needed to rule in the case, stating that not only could Blacks not be citizens, they did not have any rights whites were bound to respect. To show you how his views changed over a lifetime, let me read you another opinion from a younger Taney. A hard necessity indeed compels us to endure the slavery of evil for a time. It was imposed on us by another nation, while we're not yet in a state of colonial vassalage. It cannot be easily or suddenly removed. Yet while it continues, it is a blot on our national character. And every lover of freedom confidently hopes that it will be effectually and gradually wiped out, and earnestly looks for the means by which that necessary object may be best attained. And until it shall be accomplished, until the time shall come when we can point without a blemish to the language in the Declaration of Independence, every friend of humanity will seek to lighten the galling chains of slavery and better to the utmost of his power the wretched condition of the character. Buchanan knew what the decision in the Dred Scott case was going to be. He asked Taney to hold off on releasing it until the 1857 term so as not to interfere with Buchanan's election. As a stroke of further irony, Taney held the Bible to swear in Abraham Lincoln and the new era. The Lincoln-Douglas debates for the Senate of 1858, Lincoln caught Douglas in the Freeport Doctrine. Slavery could be prohibited from the territories by popular sovereignty. He was sunk in the South 2 years later in the four-way race for the presidency, which Lincoln won with 39% of the vote. John Brown's raid on Harper's Ferry and the election of Lincoln were the triggering events heralding the Civil War. The best history day of my life was being in DC, getting up at 4 a.m., driving out to Gettysburg, touring the battlefield, then driving to Harper's Ferry and closing out the day at Frederick Douglass's home. I felt like I had touched base with three of my heroes. Although there was initial opposition to Blacks entering the war, ultimately 187,000 Black troops fought for the Union in the Civil War, and 25,000 in the Navy fought for the North. John Quincy Adams, who died in 1848, told Massachusetts Senator Charles Sumner, "If Civil War ever breaks out, the slave could be freed based upon the military necessity clause." And so it happened. By July of 1862, Lincoln let it be known to two of his cabinet members, Seward and Welles, that he was going to free the slave. They warned him to wait until a Union victory, lest it appeared to be done from weakness. September 17, 1862 came that victory at Antietam. On the 22nd of that month, Lincoln met with his cabinet, instructing them that he was given States in Rebellion an ultimatum: return to the Union by January 1, or the enslaved in those states would be declared free. Lincoln followed the emancipation up with the 13th Amendment, which, it might surprise you, wasn't amended by Mississippi until 1995, and formally entered into its record, with the paperwork being filed, until February 7, 2013. The 13th Amendment was followed up by the 14th Amendment, ensuring equal rights under the law, and the 15th Amendment, securing the federal right to vote. The rights of the freedmen were ensured during Reconstruction, which formally ended, ushering in the Black Codes and Jim Crow in 1877. That, you will remember, was the Hayes-Tilden election, which resulted in a tie, throwing it into the House of Representatives. Hayes promising the South to remove the remaining federal troops stationed there to ensure Black voting rights. It effectively kept African Americans from the polls until the Voting Rights Act of 1965. The Congress passed an Equal Accommodations Act in 1875 and an Anti-Ku Klux Klan Act earlier in 1871, which were both ruled unconstitutional by the Supreme Court in 1883, which opened the door to Plessy versus Ferguson, declaring separate but equal the law of the land in 1896. In 1903, W.B. Boyce, the great public intellectual, sociologist, and historian, wrote in the book Souls of Black Folks, proclaiming the issue of the 20th century would be the issue of the color line. Du Bois was born in Great Barrington, Massachusetts in 1868, when Frederick Douglass was the undisputed leader of Black America. He spars with Booker T. Washington in 1903, is in opposition to Marcus Garvey, and dies August 27, 1963, the eve of the March on Washington, when the mantle is officially taken by Martin Luther King. Du Bois signed My Baby Book April 16, 1946, writing, "Here's hoping." As a result of the 1908 race riots in Springfield, Illinois, the home of Abraham Lincoln, the following year in 1909, the NAACP was formed. Between 1915 and 1970, the largest internal migration in the history of the country took place, as documented by Isabel Wilkerson in her wonderful work, Warmth of Other Suns. More than 6 million Black people moved north from the South. Cities like Detroit, Chicago, Philadelphia, Washington, D.C., New York, Black people's ranks began to swell. That trend would not reverse until 1990, when for the first time in history, more Blacks were moving south than north. There are many significant events and personalities moving the race forward, such as A. Philip Randolph's formation of the Sleeping Car Porters Union, Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters Union, the rivalry between Du Bois and Booker T. Washington, the Marcus Garvey Back to Africa movement, the New York 369th Regiment in World War I, the most decorated Union in the war, 191 days under fire, never losing an inch of ground. The entire regiment received a Croix de Guerre for the French. The riots of the Red Summer 1919. But let's quickly move through there up to 1954, when the great Thurgood Marshall and others were able to overturn the 1896 Plessy ruling with Brown versus Topeka School Board decision. Marshall worked with my dad to help equalize Black and white teacher salaries in the state of Florida, where they were paying Black teachers 47% of what they paid whites by law. They won that case, but my parents were barred from teaching in the state of Florida. That's when my dad moved here to set up 11 regional states of the NAACP at the behest of Roy Wilkins. But back to Thurgood Marshall. He won 29 of 32 cases before the Supreme Court, 9 out of 14 as Solicitor General, and never once reversed on the Second Circuit. As you know now, he was chosen by LBJ to be the first African-American to sit on the High Court. Because my parents and Marshall were friends, my mother solicited him for contribution when I ran for San Francisco Supervisor in 1971. He wrote back on court stationery saying how tickled he was that I was running, but explained that as a jurist for the Supreme Court, he was prohibited from making political contributions. He wound up the letter by saying, besides, he had two kids in college and he was broke. My first real taste of racial traumatization came in 1955 when my parents took me to hear the mother of Emmett Till, a 12-year-old Black boy shot, lynched, thrown into a river, found mangled beyond recognition for whistling at a white woman. His open casket picture on the cover of that program sears me to this day. That summer, traveling through Mississippi by train with my parents on the way to Florida, I ducked below the level of the window for fear of being shot. The 1954 integration decision was severely tested in Little Rock, Arkansas. Marin County's own Melba Patillo Beals was one of the Little Rock Nine students to integrate Little Rock High. Eisenhower had to send in the 101st Airborne to admit those students over the opposition of then Governor Orville Faubus. Kennedy's death in 1963 ushered in Lyndon Johnson, the best civil rights president who passed the 1964 Civil Rights Act, the 1965 Voting Rights Act, and the 1968 Fair Housing Rights Act. I entered Fisk University in Nashville, Tennessee in the fall of 1963, where I marched with John Lewis and witnessed the majesty of the law. The 1964 Civil Rights Act opened the door to all the places that we picketed, segregated eating establishments, movie theaters, public accommodations, such as hotels. Skip Humphrey, Vice President Hubert Humphrey's son, told me his father led the floor fight for the 64 Civil Rights Act. To let me know his father's commitment, he told me Humphrey Sr. stayed in DC while Skip Humphrey's brother and Humphrey Sr.'s other son had life-threatening surgery. Humphrey told his wife, Muriel, he couldn't come home for the surgery. The bill was just too important. Fortunately, the son lived and the bill was passed. I asked Linda Bird Johnson once what her father was thinking when he spoke to a joint session of Congress in March of 1965 and said the words, "We shall overcome." She said, "You know that old hymn, once to every man and nation comes the moment to decide." Slowly over the years, the High Court has become an arm of the Oval Office, and blatant attempts to publicize the court began. But as Lincoln once said, he who shapes public opinion is greater than he who makes statutes. Hence back to George Floyd. It's been nearly 30 years since we all witnessed the beating of Rodney King, more than 50 years since the Kerner Report on Race, concluding the United States was moving towards two nations, separate and unequal, one Black and one white. We've seen presidents base their campaigns on racial themes. Nixon's Law and Order war on drugs and glorification of the silent majority. Reagan's announcement for the presidency in Philadelphia, Mississippi, where the only thing of importance to have ever happened there was the lynching of civil rights activists Cheney, Schwerner, and Goodman. Those deaths went unmentioned while Reagan touted states' rights. He then went on to Stone Mountain, Georgia, where he said Jefferson Davis was a hero of his. He then traveled to Wilmington, North Carolina, asserting his opposition to forced busing. He opposed the King holiday. George H.W. Bush was no better, running on the Willie Horton ad, a black parolee while out on probation, murdered a white woman. He also gave us Clarence Thomas, whom I opposed on the PBS NewsHour. Fast forward to now, to arguably the most racist president in history, Donald Trump, supported by and encouraged by white supremacy. George Floyd is making an example of all of our old assumptions. Who are our heroes? What part of our history have we ignored? For me, here in Marin County, the incidents occurred for me, heading to work in overnight shift at KGO Radio in the 1980s. I would have to leave a half an hour early from my home in San Anselmo for being stopped either in the San Anselmo Police Department, Ross, or in Greenby. I eventually had to put on a coat and tie to stop by each station, identifying myself, tell me who I was when I left for work, and gave them my license plate, the type and make of my car. When the sheriff was called on for my dropping off my children from my divorced wife at half an hour late due to their not being available to me until an hour after they were due, I was met with two squad cars of sheriffs with billy clubs at the ready. This had to be resolved in the sheriff's office. It took 22 years to resolve the ugly Dixie name change battle, mostly based upon the real estate interests. Let me read you a piece I wrote for the IJ in the last month or so. Youth rising to the challenge then and now. As a teenager growing up in San Francisco's Richmond district in the 60s, Marin was a distant concept. Sure, my friend Greg Goodman's uncle, Mr. Harris, was the manager of Goodman's Lumber. He had a spacious home in Sleepy Hollow with a swimming pool I'd visit from time to time. I didn't know if I was allowed in, wasn't allowed in, but I do know I was never invited to Marin Town and Country Club, where many of my classmates luxuriated on the weekends. But my buddies who played music at Sausalito Club couldn't invite me to sing because the owner thought it might attract the wrong crowd. My social activism consisted of breaking barriers of individual consequences. As you heard earlier, at the age of 10, with the San Francisco Boys Chorus, I was the first singer of color to solo with the Cosmopolitan Opera Company. I broke the color in a multicultural casting play musical called Huckleberry Finn. Later at my own high school, where a different version of it was produced, I, along with other black students, were relegated to playing slaves. I declined. It became a huge issue. The NAACP boycotted the production. As a 16-year-old delegate to the NAACP convention in Atlanta, where my mother and I stayed in Martin Luther King's parents' home, I picketed against the city's mandated segregation. The next year, back in San Francisco, in competition with other student body presidents, I won the position of Mayor of Youth and Government Week. We competed by researching one of the city's problems. I did so on the basis of a paper I wrote on de facto segregation in the San Francisco school system. Naively, I thought by presenting the issue, it would be quickly resolved. It wasn't until 20 years later that was addressed by the school board with the assistance of the federal courts. The next year, as a 17-year-old freshman at Fisk University in Nashville, I marched with my classmate John Lewis, who went on to become a civil rights icon. All of this pales in light of what these Gen X students are doing today. The Black Lives Matter movement has caught fire. In Marin alone, students have joined the national and international movement following the murder of George Floyd. They're marching in protest from Marin City to Venda Jokes. Their voices are being heard from the streets of Tiburon to Mill Valley City Council. Recent Tam High graduate, 18-year-old Paul Loy, law, quickly put together a petition calling for the resignation of Mill Valley Mayor Sashi McKenty when she blithely dismissed a residence request she'd take a stand on white silence equal white violence. She considered it an outside issue until law and others took action. She's now reconsidered. The sheriff's budget has been scrutinized. The Marin County Community Fund is redirecting funds to make the county more racially relevant in light of current circumstances. The background of Sir Francis Drake is a topic of concern, given his history as a slaver. Should he be honored with a roadway or the school with a statue? The multiracial coalition of young people are likely to bring about more change than my generation ever did. The questions they are asking, the change they are demanding, is as likely to bring about seismic shifts in the racial landscape as what happened before. It could not come soon enough in Marin, where issues of poverty, housing, employment, and quality rank as dead last among all the counties in the state. I'm reminded of the quote from Emerson, "So nigh is grandeur to our dust, so near is God to man. When duty whispers, lo, that must, youth replies, I can." I have four children of my own. I have pretty much allowed them to find their own way in matters of race. When the boys came of age, I took them to Dipsy and had a 5-minute conversation with them. I told them the fact that they live where they do, go to the school that they do, take a book out of a library. Somebody paid a price for them, and they're going to have to pay a price for somebody else. I allowed them no squirt guns as children. I was not going to have some police officer coming to my door at dusk apologizing to me for shooting my sons because it was dusk and it looked like they were carrying real guns. I told them that when their entitled friends start doing crazy things on Halloween, call me and I'll come and pick you up. You aren't going to get the benefit of a doubt. I'm proud of them. Two of them went to Redwood, and from there one matriculated at the University of Oregon, then USF Law. He practices with the Munger firm in the city. The other, after working with Oracle and Salesforce, is now with NBC, as is his youngest brother. My daughter went to Branson, then Georgetown, and just left the speaker's office, Nancy Pelosi's office, where she spent 6 years leaving as press secretary. She's moving to New York to become a global manager for Spotify. One thing I'm proudest of is, along with my Marnie Glickman and Kerry Pearson and others, we got the name of the Dixie School District changed. It only took 22 years. The next challenge is to look at implicit bias. Lastly, in closing, when I ponder the life of George Floyd and his significance in this nation's racial awakening, I think of other martyrs for justice, simple men and women whom history used to advance her cause, some known, others not, people whose lives might have been recounted in the short and simple annals of the poor. George Floyd's final utterance mirrored that of a father, a brother, a son, a call for his mother. The circumstances of his death were even more tragic when we found out that the arresting officers, he told them he was fearful of his life. He couldn't breathe. He'd been shot once before and feared that they would kill him. And he died mercilessly at the knee of Minneapolis police, having no idea the worldwide movement his death would spark. He knew not at the time that his time was at hand that morning. Sacco and Vanzetti did, two impoverished Italian immigrants who many believe were wrongly accused of murder in 1920. They were put to death 7 years later, but not without uttering these stirring words. Had it not been for these things, we might have lived out our lives, talking at street corners to scorning men. We might have died, unmarked, unknown, a failure, but now we're not a failure. This is our career, our triumph. Never in our full life could we hope to do such work for intolerance, for justice, for men's understanding of man, as now we do by accident. Our words, our lives, and our pains, nothing. The taking of our lives, lives of a good shoemaker and a poor fisherman. This last moment belongs to us. That agony is our triumph. And so it was for George Floyd. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Noah. A lot to think about already. We're going to go to some questions now and look forward to your thoughts on these different issues. I've got, first of all, a two-part question, one that I've had bouncing around in my mind, and then we have a member of our audience who has a very related question. So I'm going to read both of them together. First of all, my thought, even before the tragic death of George Floyd, racial justice has obviously been an issue that resurfaces from time to time as a nationwide priority. Last autumn, the New York Times published the landmark 1619 Project, which was a collection of historical and opinion pieces, I'm sure you know, that was read by many and broadened the consciousness of many about racial inequality. In June of this year, another New York Times article, What is Owed, by Nicole Hannett Jones, laid out once again the case for reparations for the descendants of those whose ancestors were enslaved, which issue was rekindled about 5 years ago by Ta-Nehisi Coates in the much-read New Yorker article on the topic. The issues seem to arise, then fall off the national agenda, then come back. It leads us to wonder what will be different this time. Another way of looking at it, Dr. King, who obviously you knew personally, famously said that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. Where are we on that arc today as you see it? And before you answer, let me read a question from Marin City resident Damian Morgan. I'm abbreviating, but he writes, Being born and raised in Marin City, for those of you who aren't familiar, it's a section of Marin County toward the south. I know firsthand what the County of Marin represents and stands for. If you all want to make a difference, demand some open space be allocated to Black folk. My grandfather, Mr. Henry Garrison, worked in the shipyards, saved enough to buy a home of his choosing, and he was denied. I, Damian Morgan, the grandson of Henry Garrison, am demanding reparations now. Open space, I'm demanding acreage and the costs to build a nice home. Let's keep our fight local. Let's do what we can here in Marin City. White folk reading and listening to you, what will you do to help Black folk attain reparations? I think he's addressing that question to white folk. What will you do to help Black folk attain reparations? Thank you, Damian Morgan, Marin City. Your thoughts?
Well, that's a lot to digest there. I remember when the Japanese Americans were interned, got reparations. I think it was $20,000 a person. Nobody said much about that, although they were interned for 4 years, which is bad, no question about that. First time I learned about it was from Ken Matsuoka, first kid I met when I moved into the Richmond district. I knew his father was a gardener, his mother was domestic, and we were playing gin rummy and we were taking score on the back of a large pad that said Matsuoka Cleaners. I said, I thought your parents were domestic and a gardener. He said, well, we were until our homes were taken away from us. And I learned that his older brother and sister were born in these concentration camps, in these internment camps. But going back to the end of that question, there was reparations there for 4 years of internment. When I talked about earlier in my talk, cotton was the main export of the United States from 1803 to 1937. And we know who picked that cotton. For 250 years, there was nothing paid to them for that service to this country. Indeed, things were paid to the slave owners who had to give up their slaves. So whether reparations take the form of a direct payment or maybe education, as they've done in Georgetown for the slaves that were sold to keep the Georgetown University going, I think reparations are needed and deserved. What can white people do amongst themselves? Become allies of Black people. Listen, read some of the books. We have a bibliography of books that people can read to understand what other people's lived situations are and circumstances are. Marin Post is delivered in Marin City. Black newspaper. Reach out to friends that you have that look different from you. Have these difficult conversations. When you hear things amongst others that don't quite strike you as socially progressive, and you feel that you are socially progressive, speak out. Don't just be silent for the sake of comity, for the sake of being polite. History isn't made by polite people. It is made by those people who are willing to take a stand and move forward. So those are some of the initial thoughts that I have on that. Those two questions.
That leads me to a related question we just received from a member of our audience, David Geffen. David asks, please share your thoughts on the following. The purpose of Dr. King's marches was to get media attention. This was done by staging them in places he knew would result in violence. Peaceful protests accomplish little unless there is confrontation. Staying in the news is part of the gambit. The threat of escalated protests accomplishes this. Your thoughts?
Well, there are all different kinds of attacks to moving the arc of justice a little closer. When LBJ signed the Civil Rights Act of 64, the Voting Rights Act of 65, the Voting Rights Act of 65, he told Martin Luther King, you keep doing what you're doing on the outside, so I'm forced to keep doing what I'm doing on the inside. What happened in Birmingham, the bombing of those little girls at March 15th, 1963, the Montgomery bus boycott moved things forward to where it became part of the national attention. that there's statues now in Birmingham of those dogs attacking the young marchers peacefully marching, the Bull Connor, et cetera. Those brought to public attention what was going on. The 8 minute and 46 second death of George Floyd certainly told everybody that this was what was happening and had been happening for all the times Black people had said there was police brutality. It was not believed. It was only believed until people saw it with their own eyes. Then you had a contrast with Thurgood Marshall and guys like and Martin Luther King. Thurgood Marshall thought it was needless and counterproductive to be marching in the streets, that the real changes came about through the law. So I don't think it was an either or. I think it's a both and. And I think when you can't make people see the light, oftentimes you have to make them see the heat. I don't like to feel the heat. I don't like to see neighborhoods go up in smoke and things of that nature. But as Martin Luther King said, riots are the language of the unheard. And people do what they need to do in order to get heard when they think they can get justice no other way.
I had a question which has been echoed by some of our audience members as well. I was intending to ask your thoughts on the state of policing in Marin County. For those who aren't aware, we have numerous different local police entities here. We've got the sheriff and we've got different police departments all over the place, which is in and of itself an issue that many have asked about. But if you can pool all of those agencies in your thoughts for a moment, how are we doing in Marin in terms of our policing? And specifically, Raul McDuff asks, I just learned of the incident a couple of days ago in Tiburon on Main Street. A Black shop owner was challenged by the police in his own store. Do you have observations? Thank you.
Well, obviously there needs to be sensitivity training. There needs to be outside forces that take a look at this, not just policing themselves, essentially. I think Alice Fredericks is hiring outside folks to take a look at this particular incident, which occurred in Tiburon. For those of you unaware of it, there's only one African-American store owner, shop owner in Tiburon, and he was working doing inventory at 1 p.m. on early Friday morning when police were called. And they circled the block several times, waited outside for 20 minutes, knocked on the window, and challenged this man who happened to be a native Kenyan as to why he was there. He didn't feel like he needed to show identification as he was the shop owner himself. The majority calls that the police respond to in Marin County are people calling and saying, I've seen somebody walk down the street and they don't belong there. I think there needs to be training. Dan Daniels, who's coastal director of the NAACP, and myself, we just did sensitivity training, racial training for the district attorney's office in Marin County and also the probation department here. Otis Bruce was just elevated to deputy DA here, which is a movement forward. But in his entire time in the DA's office, he's the only African-American there, and they should be looking to moving that forward. Having African-Americans on the police forces of these various communities, having regular town hall meetings where race is a topic of discussion, where we can have honest and open interactions, I think are things that are definitely needed. And so we can have fewer incidents such as the one that occurred in Tiburon. Also, it's something that occurred to me, there was a demonstration right after the George Floyd thing that was going to take place in Tiburon and another one at the Bonaire Shopping Center. And it's interesting, the warnings that went out to people saying, you know, don't drive in this direction. We're likely to have thugs coming in from various other parts of the Bay Area, lock your doors, et cetera. And the same in Bonaire Shopping Center. Well, whereas when things were happening in Mill Valley, people didn't send out those warnings. They assumed that the marches, et cetera, would be peaceful. And I don't recall any stores being looted in either Mill Valley or in Tiburon. Thanks.
Cindy Winder asks, I can understand the history that you're reviewing so well, and I do not wish to minimize it in the least. However, here in Marin, we have many Latinos, many of whom have dark skin, And I'm wondering whether you and other Black leaders see them as allies or as a different category that must fight their own battles.
Oh, no, I definitely see all people of color as allies, all genders as allies. I remember seeing this special on CNN, despite the fact that the people who were in charge of the suffragist movement were vehement racists and really didn't care if Black women got the vote, and Black women really didn't get the vote till 1965. I was really pleased that they were able to get the vote. Everybody's struggle is our struggle, and our struggle is everybody's struggle. Until we see the world as one place where if anybody is prejudiced against, we all are prejudiced against. It's not going to be the kind of place that we need to inhabit. So I'm as much as in favor of Latino or Latinx rights for women, rights for Asian as I am for African American rights, because we're all in this together. It's not my rights over your rights or your rights over mine. We should be all helping each other in this battle.
We have a question from Eleanor Sluice. What questions are not being asked, in your opinion, Noah? As a young 9-year-old living in the Midwest, I did not become aware of skin color, but as I grew older, the issue became one of living within our family's means. It seems that the issue of wages and educational opportunities takes precedent, yet an awareness of minority fragmentation and lack of those opportunities certainly comes into the issue. What policy changes in corporations, including banks and educational institutions, do you suggest?
Well, I think they ought to make certain that there's a certain, if we're 13% of the population, then why not 13% of the folks in your organization or your company? Or if you're working in an area that's greater than that, why not make sure that that organization or company reflects the community that they serve? Or if you want to make certain that people get a different perspective, they should make sure that folks that don't look like them are included in their workforce and listen to them. Sometimes it's not just enough. You get the recruitment, but you don't get the retention. And people don't feel often heard in these groups and organizations. I worked at the Department of Social Services from 1985 to 1990, and an African American was recruited to a top level position, an African American woman, and the white women tried to freeze her out. Well, the head of that department called those white women in, and he said, "Look, if she doesn't work out, you don't work out." So it was amazing how quickly overnight the attitudes of these people change. Everything starts at the top. People have to know that the person at the top has the kinds of views that that encourage equity, diversity, and inclusion. I just became a member of the board of the Marin Theater Company, and they're adhering to a request that 60% of the people working or on the board, or 60% of the people of the plays that are presented have an African-American theme until we get some kind of equity. And that's being adhered to at this point. I don't say that has to be in every particular industry or workplace, but it needs to be something that people consider. If you're white and you go into a firm and you don't see any Black people there, it's something that should be a part of your consciousness. Why aren't there any Black folks here? Why aren't there any Asians? Why aren't there any Latinx folks here? We want to make sure that everybody's represented in this company or organization.
So that leads to an interesting question. The presence of Black folks at certain places. Here's a question from one of our attendees. How do you explain the support of Black men at Trump's GOP convention?
Well, there's always going to be one in every crowd, I suppose. Some people get paid off. Other people, I worked for the an organization once where the head of it was an African-American man who was a Republican. He said, "I don't want to get in the long line. I want to get in the short line." There are some self-hating Blacks, just like there are self-hating Jewish people. There are other people that just don't see things the way the majority of folks. Clarence Thomas is a key example for me. I mean, here's a guy that in every case that is key to Black advancement, he votes against. I can't figure it out. I think he thinks he's the exception, that he's the one who made it without any help. He didn't stand on anybody else's shoulders. He was the first person that was qualified. That was the worst thing that H.W. Bush ever said or did. And here he stands at Kenny Buckboard saying the most qualified warrior in America today is Clarence Thomas. Well, that wasn't true then, and it's not true now. He didn't get into Holy Cross just because he was qualified. There was affirmative action going on. Didn't get into Yale just because he was qualified. There was affirmative action going on. People forget where they came from. They forget on whose shoulders they stand and want to think, as the other people around him, white primarily, will tell them, you just made it on your own. You're exceptional. You're different. Why can't the others be like you? Well, Paul Rubison was heads and shoulders above everybody, but he didn't forget where he came from. Frederick Douglass was heads and shoulders above everybody. He didn't forget where he came from. But guys like Clarence Thomas bother me because they do forget where they came from, and they want to pull up the drawbridge after they're in the castle.
Here's a suggestion. Again, this is from Eleanor Sluice. Apropos of how to level the playing field, can we give laptops and internet access to students in all of the schools? And then we have another question, which may tie into that, maybe not, depends on how you feel about it. This is one of our audience members who asks, what are three concrete actions that we as Marin residents can take that will create more racial equality and justice in our county?
Yeah, I think that taking the first part of the question first, I think that every kid should have a laptop or a computer or access to the internet, or else they're not going to be a part of this century, this learning process, particularly during COVID. There are a number of things that people can do. There are groups called Surge, showing up for racial justice. Marin County organization encourages everyone to join the multiracial movement for racial justice that works with local Black, Indigenous, and people of color, BIPOC organizations, and community leaders towards this goal. Much of their resources are dedicated to the Marin City Health and Wellness Center, which supports African-American health equity, and the Multicultural Center of Marin in San Rafael, which works with the underserved communities in Marin to advance their social, cultural, and economic well-being. Color of Change, although it's not directly in Marin, is an Oakland-based organization charity that challenges injustice and systems of inequality and seeks to advance solutions towards racial justice and equality via public awareness. Cypress Mandela Training Center, that's here in the San Francisco Bay Area, a charity moving to the levels of individuals and families primarily by providing economic security via pre-apprenticeship construction programs and life skill training in addition to other employment. There's the Equal Justice Initiative that's working to end racial inequality, excessive punishment, and mass incarceration. There's a Public Justice Center. Public Justice Center seeks to build a just society by pursuing systematic change towards economic and racial equity, focusing on using legal tools to challenge poverty and racial inequity. There's a Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights Under Law, nationally and local communities in Denver, in San Francisco. Charity supports voting rights, fair housing, community development organizations. There is also an organization in Mill Valley that is fighting for fair housing, which is another organization. If you write to me here at noah@noahgriffin.com or noahgriffinlifeforce@gmail.com, I'll send you the name of that organization, which escapes me right now. But those are some organizations you can become a part of.
The questions are all interlacing, and it's hard for me to think about how to divide them up. I'd like to follow up from what you were just talking about. We have a question from one of our board members, Alan Shavitz, who asks, as a white man, what can I do to recognize my own white privilege? And let me add a sort of footnote question to that. How do you answer those in the white community who reject the notion that they have white privilege?
Well, the latter part of that question is answered in in Isabel Wilker's book, Cast, just to how people are portrayed. Become aware of these things. Listen to this. A little more than one out of five African-Americans, 22%, are poor. And they make up over just one quarter of poor people in America at 27%. But a 2017 study by Travis Dixon, the University of Illinois, found that African-Americans count for 59% of the poor people depicted in the news. White families make up two-thirds of America's poor at 66%, but account for only 17% of poor people encountered in the news. The generations-old distortion shaped popular sentiment. A political scientist at Yale, Martin Gillens, found in a 1994 study that 55% of Americans believe that all poor people in America were Black. Thus, a majority have come to see Blacks as a synonym for poor, a stigmatizing distortion of a country that glorifies affluence, like poverty, crime, too, receives coverage out of proportion to the numbers. Crimes involving Black suspects and white victims make up 42% of the crimes reported on television news, even though crimes with those white victims and Black suspects make a minority of crimes at 10%, according to the Sentencing Project, an advocate for criminal justice reform. For generations, the white culture has decried the alarming rate of births among Black teenagers, often accompanied by pictures of welfare dependency, even though the majority of teenage mothers of all races are unmarried and likely to require help. But one might not know that from news coverage, that the rate of Black teenagers giving birth has plummeted in recent decades, from 118 for 1,000 Black teenagers in 1981 to 28 for 1,000 in 2017, according to a 2019 analysis by the nonprofit research center, Child Trends. Well, that you can find in the book, Cast. But, you know, going outside of your comfort zone, joining organizations like the NAACP, Urban League, and other organizations, subscribing to a Black newspaper, reading the books that we're suggesting at the end of this program, speaking up and speaking out whenever you hear something that you think is racist is one way you start the conversation. If you have a book club, reading these books is important. And just being aware. I know that these are small things, but so many times I'm talking to someone white and somebody else walks up and they just break into the conversation as if I'm not even there. Being aware of that. If I'm in a line and Safeway, I move very close to the person in front of me because I know if somebody wants to move, they're going to move right in front of me perpendicularly and not say a word. I'm going to make them say, excuse me. If I'm on a bus in a situation, and there's a seat open next to me, I will sit in the aisle. I will make someone ask to sit next to me because I will be the last person sat next to. So just becoming aware of those things in those situations is being helpful. Doing what you can do yourself, not maybe making major change in society, but thinking a little bit differently. How is somebody else impacted by what I'm doing? How is somebody else impacted by what I'm saying? How is somebody else impacted by not speaking? The old definition of an N-word is that African-American gentleman who just left the conversation.
We have a question from an audience member who has a personal connection to you. This is Lauren Gabriel Wasserman, who writes, I went to the University of Michigan with and befriended your son, Noah, also named Noah. I'm curious if you were living life through his and my generation, what would your hope be for social equality going forward if we could accomplish something new in our lifetime?
Oh, I think what you kids have done has just been marvelous in your lifetime. So many kids just don't see color today. They really don't. And it was so different from my lifetime. All of my kids went to majority schools. One to the University of Michigan with you, another one to the University of Oregon, one to Georgetown, and one to Jesuit school, Fairfield University in Connecticut. In my day, all those options weren't open. And I've been told to go where you're celebrated, not where you're tolerated. The fact that I went to an all-Black school was liberating for me after having gone to all-white schools. If a gal didn't go out with me, she just didn't like me. if I didn't get my lesson, it wasn't because I was dumb. I just didn't study, and I'd better live up to the potential I was supposed to live up to. If I raised hell with my frat brothers after a beer bus, nobody raised windows and said, look, as those so-and-sos. They were just kids having fun. So I needed that extra padding, I suppose, to be able to deal with the world. Whereas my children didn't. They have their close black friends, but they have a lot of white friends. So I really see hope in this younger generation. When I see interraciality on TV ads, a lot of people thought that Bryant Gumbel wasn't going to last on the Today Show because white America couldn't stand waking up in the morning to a black man sitting next to a black woman doing the news. And that's not true today. The multicultural casting of Hamilton was a real breakthrough. We're experiencing a time that's unique and new in society. And I applaud all of you young people for the work that you're doing. And I think that this is going to be a different world based upon the work that you're doing. And God bless you, Laura.
Great to hear all that. We have two board members who have similar questions. I'll read them together. From Nadine Muller, as a member of the Marin County Civil Grand Jury Association, we want to have Black and Latino members apply to be on the civil grand jury and have not been very successful. How can we reach these citizens and explain to them that their voices can be heard better by serving on the grand jury and help us all better understand the needs of their communities? And then David Gabriel writes, shuffling here, people of sincerity and goodwill will continually reach out to racial, religious, ethnic, and gender minorities to engage. How can we ensure diversity in our public agencies, our boards, our commissions, and our nonprofits, including those like the Marin Coalition?
Well, I guess make sure that it's a priority and that you don't stop until you get the job done. I remember when I was working to integrate the San Francisco Police Force and the San Francisco Fire Department. Oh, we'd love to hire, but we can't find anybody that's qualified. Well, that was a dodge. There were plenty of people out there who was qualified once it became a priority for them to have it be a priority. There are plenty of qualified people, and there have always been plenty of qualified people, but you can't stop until you accomplish your goal. I don't know about the other particular communities that you're talking about although I have some friends on the grand jury, but please contact me. I have some friends that I think might very well want to serve on the grand jury who appreciate the good work that the grand jury does in bringing these issues to the fore. But don't stop. I became the president of my Rotary Club. Although I live in Tiburon, I belong to the Rotary Club in Larkspur. And one of the members of my club said, you know, we don't have diversity. And so we got the list of 40 businesses, 40 black businesses. And we wrote to every one of these businesses asking people to just consider our club. We'd like to diversify. And we've got a couple of members now. It's a very small club, and we're going to continue to work until we get more members. And I think you have to have that kind of energy, that kind of goal, that kind of mission in mind, and don't stop until you get it. I was working for the Hearst Examiner at one point, and the president of China came through, premier of China, and that was on page 5, but the resume of a Chinese person of the Fang family who wanted to purchase the Examiner, he fudged on his resume, and that was on page 1. I guarantee if you had somebody Asian in the room, that would have happened. There was, hey, wait a minute, look at what you guys are doing. So there is an advantage to having people on these juries, on these boards. And just don't stop. And that's going to be on you to reach out until you find. If you had black friends of your socioeconomic strata, you'd probably know who to talk to. So it's on you, I think, to reach out until you accomplish that goal. And it needs to be a goal. But thank you for doing it.
Let me move on. It's one of my questions. We've just experienced the loss of John Lewis, not that long ago, Elijah Cummings. Originally, I drafted the question, where do you see the movement in 30 years and who will be the leaders? As I think about that question, it assumes a movement will be needed in 30 years. So I don't know if I like that question, but that's how I drafted it up. How do you want to take it?
Well, I don't know if we will ever achieve true freedom and equality. I think each generation's ceiling is the next generation's floor. You have to take it as far as you can for the next generation to pick it up. My grandfather, who was born enslaved in 1852, couldn't imagine the world that I live in now. And I'm sure I won't be able to imagine the world that these young folks live in the future. But what I see in terms of the African American community is women coming to the fore. You know, the mayor of Chicago, the mayor of Atlanta, the mayor of Washington, D.C., the mayor of San Francisco. 30 years ago, I was working with London Breed as she was working at Treasure Island as a young intern. I had no idea. You turn around one day and she would be the mayor of San Francisco. It's just great. Back in, it was maybe in 2004, something like that. I was at Third Baptist Church because they were talking about Earl Sanders, the police chief of San Francisco, being embattled in the Fajita Gate scandal. And there was this woman that afterwards came up to me, you need to help me out. I'm running for DA in San Francisco and I need your help and I need your assistance. Sure, I'll give you help and I'll give you assistance. Well, it turned out to be that little woman became DA, she became senator, and now she's vice presidential candidate for the United States of America. So I see the hope in the young African-American females who are coming along and will be the leaders of tomorrow. And I think that's with the amount of sexism in the African-American male community, I'm real happy to see that.
So Noah, as we've discussed, I'm reading Begin Again, which essentially goes into the life of James Baldwin, who famously moved to Europe because he didn't feel he was welcome in the United States, if I can paraphrase. We have a question here from a dear friend of mine, Alexis Lober, who writes, I read about a movement of selected US citizens, people of color, who struggle in the United States and decide that Europe is a better home for them. They emigrate, for example, to Germany, or in Baldwin's case, it was France, where they feel more welcome, more accepted, and more appreciated as an American, especially in the arts. Is this coping mechanism of immigration too defeatist?
Well, I belonged to the Jubilee Singers when I was in college, and they gained fame in the United States by joining together to mass enough money to be able to continue their university, which started in 1866, was going out of business in 1871. They stopped singing magicals, started singing spirituals, which they introduced to the concert stage, were a big hit in Plymouth Church, Henry Ward Beecher's church in New York, and then went on to sing before all the crown heads of Europe. When they got to England, there were two or three of the members who were men who refused to come back to the United States because they felt more like a human being there than ever before. Frank Yerby, one of the great writers, did the same. There's a book called Paris Noir, which talks about expatriates who went to France and stayed there, Josephine Baker being one. The great W.B. Du Bois died in Ghana because he felt he couldn't get equal treatment here. Paul Robeson, if I'm not mistaken, spent some time in Russia. But you find there's a different kind of racism in these various places. I was given a 10-day all-expense paid fellowship to England when I was the press secretary to the mayor. And I felt it was more class than caste over there. But the people who lived there assured me that it was indeed both. There are those who feel that they can't take it here. They're treated better in other places. But I, for one, am determined to stay here and fight and get the America that I my forebears struggle for. My great-grandfather fought, my great-grandfather, born in 1840, fought in the Civil War. My father fought in World War I. I have an uncle that fought in World War II and a cousin who fought in Desert Storm. So we fought to make this country what it is, and I'm going to stay here and make sure that we get our share, and others who are not as fortunate get their share. Thank you.
Let me move to the future, potentially. Any thoughts on Kamala Harris?
Well, I'm a big fan of hers. I'm a big fan of Joe Biden's. I think that they will do well if the thumb isn't on the scale, if we can successfully fight the post office and successfully fight the Russians and others who might want to interfere with this. I think the question for Kamala Harris will be, if Joe Biden considers himself a bridge to the next generation, will enough white women see themselves in Kamala Harris to move forward if she runs for president 4 years from now? Because you'll have to remember, 53% of white women voted against Hillary Clinton, one of, quote, their own, and 45% of them were college educated. I remember the late Cokie Roberts said on the ABC program on Sunday mornings, white women will decide this election. And indeed they did, but not in the way most people thought they might have. So I think this time around that Kamala Harris is middle class enough and speaks to both white and black people. I know black women will turn out in droves for her. And I think women in general, specifically suburban women, will turn out for her. So I think she'll do well. I think one of the things she has to ward against is they're going to look pretty closely at her record as Attorney General in California, which some find somewhat controversial. But I think given the opposition, Trump and Pence, I think if there's no cheating, I think that they'll do well. And on November 4th, we'll wake up to a new administration, not the surprise that we woke up to 4 years ago.
Okay, let me try to bring it home here. In the last few minutes, we've got some observations and requests, if you will, from some of our audience. Rich, I'm going to say Chimino asks.
Maybe Savino.
Oh, okay, you know him.
There's a Savino that played for the Giants. Savino that was a broadcaster, KSFO, I think. Ask if he's any relation.
Yeah. I will. He asks, would you have a webinar on Cole Porter and jazz greats? hold your thoughts. We have Ron Brown who says, when are you going to write a memoir? Have you ever considered preparing a collection of your remarks as well as insights such as those you're sharing here? Also, could you share how the teachings and thoughts of Howard Thurman impacted you and your dad? Thanks, your classmate, Ron Brown. Go ahead.
I'm so happy that Ron Brown is on this. We were dear friends. I think I introduced him to his wife, who was a classmate of mine at Fisk, who went on to leave Fisk to go to Harvard Law. And she was Phi Beta Kappa at Fisk and has had a wonderful career. And Ron's sister has written the book on Thomas Jefferson and slavery. I would like to write my memoirs if I thought I had anything worthwhile to say. Even if it's just for the family, I should do that. My friend Kevin Starr said, take 3 hours a day and put things down, and over a period of time that you will have accomplished something. I love Cole Porter. I love the jazz greats of that era. I wound up, when I was in law school, being sent by the dean to Cole Porter's law firm because I thought I wanted to go into music full-time at that point. It didn't happen. I got waylaid for 45 years in government, politics, and media. But when I retired from that, I thought I'd go back into music, and all our Cole Porter concerts sold out. So we thought we would join the existing Cole Porter Society, and were surprised to find out that there was no Cole Porter Society. So my wife says, Meredith, why don't we form one? So we wrote down what we wanted to do and sent it off to the successor of the man that I had talked to when I was in law school. And so they checked with the family, and within 2 days we got a response, go with our blessings. So we went to the Cole Porter Music Festival that next year in Peru, Indiana. We met the collateral descendants of his family, sang at the festival, and a big supporter of the Cole Porter Society sent us to New York to find a lost Cole Porter show that was done in in 1928 called Les Ambassadors. We got the rights to debut it on the West Coast and debuted in Marin County and also at the Herbst Theater in San Francisco. And the one thing I was proudest of is that the 100th anniversary of the birth of Frank Sinatra, they were doing all these small shows around in cabarets. And we thought, why don't we do a big show? It's worthy of it. So we rented the Herbst Theater. But what we forgot was the rehabilitated Herbst Theater went from 600 seats to 1,000 seats. And we wondered how we're going to be able to fill it. Well, the pink sheet in the Chronicle gave us three pages. And we filled that. We had a 17-piece orchestra, et cetera. And we got a nice response. And for the wonderful question about Howard Thurman is one of the finest theologians this country and the world has ever produced. He graduated with my dad from the Florida Baptist Academy in 1915, went on to Morehouse, and became the first dean of Rankin Chapel at Howard University, and later became dean of School of Religion at BU in 1952. He's written over 20 books. He's considered one of the greatest mystics the world has ever produced. A very, very deep thinker. And I was proud to be a pioneering member of the church when he came out here in 1944. He was sent a letter by Dr. Alfred Fisk, head of theology at San Francisco State, to send a young student out to form the first interracial non-denominational church in the country. Thurman was so intrigued with the idea, he took a leave of absence from Howard University to come out here and establish the church himself. And we had such luminaries as Eleanor Roosevelt on the board of the church. It was said at the time that the 11 o'clock on Sunday morning was his most segregated hour in America. Thurman was a mentor to Martin Luther King. King's first year at BU was Thurman's last year at Boston University. And Thurman actually led the first delegation of African Americans to meet with Gandhi in 1935. One of Gandhi's entourage asked him, "Why are you a Christian?" "Because it's in the name of Christianity, your people were enslaved." Thurman thought about that, came back and wrote the book, Jesus and the Disinherited. What would Jesus do with the pariahs, with the outcasts of society? Martin Luther King was never without a copy of that book. One of the joys of my life was that Mrs. Thurman once gave me a piece of cloth that Gandhi himself had taken from cotton, which was supposed to go to England. It was an act of protest, and let me hold that. In San Francisco, they have what I call the Triangle of Peace. You have the Gandhi statue at the down at the Embarcadero Center, and at 235 Market Street, you have Howard Thurman with a list of other notable contributions as a bas relief on the building of that. And then you have Martin Luther King waterfall over in Embarcadero Center. So all these three people who influenced one another. When I look back on who I would consider the greatest men of the 20th century, it would be Gandhi, Martin Luther King, and Nelson Mandela. They were able to change a society with the power of love, nonviolent love, and without firing a shot. So a great legacy that these three people of color has left, along with John Lewis. A friend of mine asked the other day, he said, "Do you know of anybody who lived a more Christian life of those people that spoke that day, August 28th, 1963, than John Lewis?" And I don't. He was really basically a secular saint. A long-winded answer to your questions, but thank you for asking them.
Okay, let's take us out with a final thought about where you go from here. Tell us about your current projects, what's on the horizon, and what can we expect from Noah Griffin coming up, pandemic or not?
Well, a lot of things are on the horizon. Oddly enough, I know a guy who lives in Marin County by the name of Dave Pettis. We've been friends for 25 years, and then midway through our friendship, I asked, "Dave, are you any kin to Edmund Pettis of the Edmund Pettis Bridge?" He says, "As a matter of fact, I'm a direct descendant of his." And since then, we've worked on projects to bring Byron Stevenson to North California here. He helped form the strategy to eliminate the name Dixie. So I wrote a piece on it for the IJ a couple of weeks ago. Oddly enough, it was picked up by the local newspaper in Selma, Alabama. Dave is in favor of the name change of the bridge. We hooked him up with a town hall meeting in Selma, where the residents of Selma, Alabama got an opportunity to voice their wishes, which they don't want the bridge named for John Lewis. John Lewis didn't want the bridge named for him. They may be overruled by the million or so people whose signatures are there indicating that they'd like the bridge named for John Lewis. But he is in favor of any direction in which the town fathers and mothers want to take this, although the ultimate decision will be with the state of Alabama. But to bring Dave Pettis, a member of the Pettis family, along with the folks in Selma, and for somebody that knew John Lewis and marched with John Lewis, that's one of the projects. I wrote a song for the swab testing we hope to get somebody to pick up. I write song parodies that are heard every Wednesday morning on Sonoma Radio, and I'll sing it for you. You should be swab testing in the negative. Make sure that you're not positive. Wear masks as a preventative. Don't mess with Mr. In-Between. Don't want to spread COVID to the maximum. Keep risks down to the minimum. Stay safe or pandemonium likely to walk upon the scene. To illustrate my last remark, don't want you to fail, fall short of the mark. What can you do when everything seems so stark? You should be swab testing in the negative. Make sure that you're not positive. Wear masks as a cooperative. Don't mess with Mr. In-Between. No, don't mess with Mr. In-Between. Yeah.
I could not have planned that. I did not plan that, people. Noah, thank you. Unfortunately, thank you. The time's flown. We have to sign off. I want to thank our amazing guest, Noah Griffin, for sharing his experiences and his insights with us. We've got a lot to think about. He's given us a book list. We'll find a way to put that on the website so you'll have access to his recommendations on reading. I want to remind you again, our next event is September 17 at 12 noon. When we'll be presenting the Marin Registrar of Voters, Linda Roberts. Finally, I want to give a big thank you to our webmaster, the spectacular Alan Shavitz, without whose amazing expertise, absolutely, we would not have been able to do this program. Thank all, there he is. Thank you, Alan. And thank all of you for joining us. This obviously was our maiden voyage. I hope it went okay from your perspectives. We're very, very pleased to have had a terrific audience, I think our largest audience in my memory, which I attribute entirely to Noah's draw. So thank you for that, starting us off big in the virtual world, Noah, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, we're gonna say goodbye, and I'm gonna send us off with, in Noah's honor, Johnny Mercer and the Pied Pipers. And if I can get this queued up, we're going to hear Accentuate the Positive. Thanks, everybody, for joining us. Here we go.
Gather around me, everybody. Gather around me while I preach some. Feel a sermon coming on me. The topic will be sin, and that's what I'm again. If you wanna hear my story, then settle back and just sit tight while I start attitude of doing right. You got to accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative, and latch on to the affirmative. Don't mess with Mr. In-Between. maximum, bring gloom down to the minimum, have faith or pandemonium, liable to walk upon the scene. To illustrate my last remark, Jonah in the whale, Noah in the ark. What did they do just when everything looked so dark? Man, they said we better accept. You hate the positive, even might hate the negative, and latch on to the affirmative. No mess with Mr. In Between. No, don't mess with Mr. In Between. You got to accentuate the positive, yes, yes. Mind it the negative and latch on, yes, yes. To the affirmative, don't mess with Mr. In Between. No, don't mess.